Good evening, everyone. I'm going to go ahead and introduce the three panelists. First one is Ms. Isra Brifkani. She was born in Duhok, Kurdistan, and immigrated in the U.S. with her family in 1997. Isra realized her passion for education, filed in education field in her sophomore year in college. She received her bachelor's and master's and recently her doctorate in education from Middle Tennessee State University. Currently, Isra works with Nashville International Academy, or is known as NIA. She's working with Whole Child Project and plans to continue a path of education and research. The next panelist is Farishta Mohammadi. She was born in Rojhelat, Kurdistan. She moved to the United States in 1994 and has lived in Nashville since then. She received her Bachelor's of Science degree in psychology from David Lipscomb and went on to receive her Master's of Science in degree in clinical mental health counseling from Lipscomb University. She specializes in play therapy, excessive art therapy. Farishta is currently working on a licensure as a postgraduate from Lipscomb University. Lipscomb University's Counseling Center. She's also a real estate agent working with Realty of America buying and selling homes. So if you guys need Farishta to sell your home or buy a home, call her. And if you need some counseling, call her. She'll do two jobs at the same time. The next panelist is Binyad Sharif. He's an activist who currently working for the Tennessee Immigrant and Refugee Rights Coalition, or known as TURC. He has been involved in activism since he and his family were affected by the travel ban while en route to the U.S. with the special immigration visa that were issued or obtained as a result of his father's work as a translator for the U.S. government in Iraq. After being sent back to Iraq, they were able to mobilize family, friends, media, and elected officials in the U.S., ultimately resulting in an exception of being granted to allow them back to the United States. They moved to Tennessee in early 2017, where they were warmly greeted by hundreds at the Nashville airport. So we will go ahead and start with our panel discussion, and once we are done, I will open up the for questions and answers, so please ask as many questions as you want. We want this to be as interactive as possible.
Welcome, panelists. They look so happy. I'm going to change the questions on them. They've been preparing, by the way. Okay, so the first question I have is a general question for all three of you. If you can elaborate in your own profession with some of the barriers and obstacles that you have faced, especially while going through your education.
Assalamu alaikum. First of all, it's an honor for me to be here today, and I really want to thank all the organizers who have worked so hard for the past several months to put this conference together. And really, this conference is a great step forward to addressing the challenges to education that we have in our community. So of course, if we were to talk about challenges to education, we can spend a long time addressing all the challenges. But for today, I wanted to focus on one that I think hinders many of the youth in our community from achieving their goals and achieving their dreams in life. So when we think about, I think as a community, we have a fixed mindset about what it means to be an educated person, what a good degree is, okay? And for many of us, when our kids approach us about pursuing education or degrees outside of the engineering, medical, science, or law, then many of us give the perception to our youth that anything else is less valuable. So I think as a community we can take a step back, we can refresh our mindset about education. When we give the idea to our youth that education is their human right, and it's also their right to pursue their dreams and their goals in life. I mean, as long as they choose something that adds value to their life and the lives of the people around them, something that helps them earn an honest and good living, something that helps them become better human beings and help the people around them, then by all means we have to encourage them, we have to support them, and whenever we see our youth, we have to give them the message that they are our future. We believe in them, okay? And they are very capable and smart. And really all it takes is to believe in yourself, believe in your dreams, and work really hard. So I think this change of mindset will get us a long way as a start.
Being a refugee or immigrant, barriers come in a lot of different shapes and forms. Of course, sometimes your very own existence here can be a source of discomfort or a source of challenge. Whenever we were deported back to Iraq, that was our first experience in the United States. My first experience was not being welcomed here and being sent back, and that sent me a message of that there's a lot of challenges ahead. And I believe that after coming here, spending time here for a year now, barriers come in a lot of different shapes and forms, and sometimes just the difference in your name, your pronunciation, the way you talk, the way you dress can be barriers. They can be sorts of challenges, sorts of, But what I want to say is that the way that I've overcome those barriers and the way we can overcome those barriers by firm belief in our in ourselves. I mean, when we were deported back to Iraq, we had a firm belief that something was wrong, that we can be this wrong, can be corrected. And it was this firm belief that motivated me to speak out and to tell my story and the story of my family to the entire world. And the way the US Americans reacted was that they felt sympathetic. They thought they agreed with me because of my belief that we could share my story. And the American people did not think that sending away refugees and immigrants is not the American way, and that American is for everybody, and this is a country of immigrants and refugees.
Thank you. So I'll take your question and actually answer it from a mental health standpoint. There are many barriers and obstacles to education that the youth in our community are facing. There are especially barriers related to mental health that they face. There's stigma, there's anxiety and panic, there's depression, there's grief and loss, there are family problems, there is homesickness, for example, with those that move away for college or live on campus. There is substance abuse, there is trauma and stress. Trauma and stress is oftentimes carried from refugee experiences. Many of our youth are first and second generation children, and they often carry greater responsibility within the family. Lack of knowledge regarding post-secondary schooling is another barrier, especially regarding career options. A lack of role models is a barrier, and that's another reason why this Kurdish Professionals Organization is so important to our community. Often, other non-Kurdish college students are surrounded by family and friends and parents who have been through the college and career process, and they have many resources and network connections that make the process easier for them. And so this is a huge step for our community to overcome this barrier.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, I would like this to be as interactive as possible. So as probably all of you can see, the life journey of the panelists, including myself, we're all passionate, we're all motivated, obviously, to speak about our journey and the struggles, the obstacles that you've gone through. Most of us are first generation of immigrants here, so sometimes I feel like those have suffered the most than someone that, like my son, who was born here. I hope to God that he doesn't go through a lot of the struggles that I went through. So I'm going to open up more questions that's more specific to their profession. So if we start off with Ms. Isra, can you discuss some of the challenges that you have faced on your education journey as an immigrant student and the way you dealt with them.
So being an immigrant student obviously comes with a lot of challenges because you have to navigate challenges on so many different levels. You have the language barrier, you have the culture shock, you have the social, emotional, and mental stress that you have to deal with, among many others. You have the lack of access. So of course, one of the things that helped me the most, of course, was my family support. Having that family support throughout, that encouragement was the number one. But if I were to talk about some other things that have really helped me throughout my journey, not just academically, because education is so much more than academics. The first one I would say is knowing your values. They say that when you know your values, making choices and why becomes much easier. So it's those values that help us make choices every day, not necessarily the environment and the influence that is around us. And I learned that you gain the respect of people by upholding these values dearly, okay? And Malcolm X, this quote is coming to mind from Malcolm X. He said that if you don't stand up for something, you will fall for anything. So that's one thing. So number two is what you do after you fail. So it's inevitable that all of us will fail one time or another. Some of us will fall harder than others, but it's what we do after that makes a huge difference in life. So when we fail, we have, it's okay to beat yourself over it for a couple of days or hours, but then you have to get up, you have to dust your knees, you have to put on a band-aid, put a smile, and you have to keep moving forward. And these risks and challenges help us get out of our comfort zone, because they say, that your comfort zone is a very nice place, but nothing ever grows there. Okay? And the third one, really quickly, is to read. And I didn't realize this power until very late in my college career. Because you can get some of the best education by reading. So read anything and everything that you can get your hands on. Because you never know when you're going to get an idea or an inspiration from. So those three, I think, are powerful and help me a lot.
I guess just on that note, in terms of reading, as you all know, the first word that came down from the Quran was "iqra," means read. So it's very, very important reading, especially starting from a very young age. So thank you, Ms. Isra. Ms. Frishta, can you talk about some of the mental health stigma, especially in the Kurdish community? And what are some of those contributing factors? Because as you know, mental health is one of those, especially in our community, that's really bestowed upon. Not many folks are very comfortable talking about it, or they have a very lack of knowledge about it. So I know from Kurdistan, growing up there, when someone, we used to have a lot of what they would call crazy people in the street.
But how many of you have you seen crazy shit people here in the United States? None, because a lot of those in Kurdistan, they were misdiagnosed because of this stigma. So I would like for you to elaborate on that stigma and the effects or the contributing factors around you.
Let me make sure this one's working. Thank you, Kenneth. So yes, there are stigmas related to mental health in every community, actually. For example, therapy or counseling was actually started by a white woman. Yet within the Caucasian community, there's still a very big stigma surrounding counseling. Majority of my clients at Lipscomb University are Caucasian, and you'd be surprised by the things that they come into our sessions and they say to me. As far as our community, some stigmas or misconceptions are mental health. Mental illness is caused by brain disease. To overcome mental health issues, simply make dua, go pray. People who are having symptoms of depression or anxiety have weak iman. If a person is hearing voices, it means they are possessed by a jinn. Mental illness is caused by something bad that is happening to you. So we're all familiar with the concept of the evil eye, or black magic, jinns, or nafs. These are spiritual explanations instead of mental health diagnoses. But in the case of schizophrenia, which is a disorder of the mind characterized by visual and auditory hallucinations, oftentimes we hear people say, it's nafs, or it's jinn. Or like Kenna said, Sheta or Dewanea or Dina, like if we say these types of things. A lack of knowledge and awareness on mental health is a huge contributing factor to the stigma that exists. Cultural value of hiding problems or internal issues, not sharing those problems or burdens with others in the family or others in the community is another contributing factor. Pride and reputation are huge factors. Often mental illness is seen as a black and white issue. Either you're crazy or you're not. I have done therapy work with Middle Eastern clients, and one of their biggest concerns always is confidentiality. And please keep in mind, like, during our sessions with every client, it's always confidential. I mean, in an initial session, we always sign our contracts and we sign confidentiality paperwork. So
by law, you're required, right?
Yes, by law, we are required to do that. But yeah, with my Middle Eastern clients, the biggest concern still is confidentiality, because they fear friends or family members finding out they're in counseling and it's bringing down the reputation of their family because they are crazy or something is wrong with them. Ish devini is a Kurdish word for mental illness, but how often do we even use that word? Because we as a community, we try to avoid it. We try not to talk about mental illness. Instead, we resort to negative connotations such as dina, shita, or dewanea.
Yep, that's very true. And unfortunately, we continue to have that struggle, you know, especially with a lot of our female population that go through childbirth and they deal with the postpartum depression.
Yeah, postpartum depression is very common after childbirth. And I actually recently presented at a Muslim women's retreat, and I talked to Muslim women about postpartum depression. And you'd be surprised at how in the beginning, when we talked about mental health, like many would not open up. But as we started to get more into the topic and they started to realize this is a safe place and others have also gone through this, they would talk about it and they would open up.
That's right. That's right. It's all about communication and being confident with your struggles and talking to someone about it. Now, Mr. Vinyard, being a refugee in this country, can you tell me what does it really mean when they say achieve the American dream? As you, all of us probably in this auditorium have heard of that statement from, you know, time to time. So can you tell us as a refugee what does that mean, achieving the American dream?
Yeah, so I mean, every single person has their own dream, and when they say the American dream, I think the focus is that crazy dream is actually achievable, and that if you work hard enough, you actually can get that dream, no matter how outlandish it may seem at first. For me and for my family, every single one of us has their own dream and their own passion they're pursuing, and it could be as simple as just owning your home, making enough money that you have time for your family and for yourself, or it could be something very ambitious. For me personally, I think that dream was to pursue my education and study in the field of computer sciences. And I want to ask the audience, is anybody here wanting to apply to university very soon? Raise your hands.
We have a few,
yes you do. I think every single one of us should strive to pursue their education and that not be intimidated by the education system and by the high or the difficultness that's surrounding it. What's your dream school and go apply for there. They need you more than you need them. You have, as immigrants and refugees, you all have amazing stories that you can share with people, you can share within your profession, that you can fuse with your profession. I think you can go apply for Harvard, go apply for the top school, and never think that you're not deserving. You believe that they need you, and they are looking for people like you, and they're just waiting for you to go out and to apply to them.
And I guess you can agree with me that, and I think Ms. Bayan also highlighted on this point too, but I, as an immigrant that I grew up here, you know, our parents, they all have a goal in their mind for us, and they, in the Kurdish community especially, there's three professions that's mostly known. It's either you have to become a doctor, you have to become a lawyer, or an engineer. And unfortunately, a lot of times the parents, they go through a this phase with their child where they're, you know, the child gets stuck in this mindset, I have to be a doctor, and they try to go and take biology and chemistry, and they're not doing so well, and then the child starts to feeling like they're a failure, then they get stuck, and they start to not pursue year on year, next thing you know, they're in their mid-30s, late-30s, and the years have gone by, but they haven't really achieved something. So that's, you know, it's very important that when they say that achieving the American dream is, as an individual, what is it that you like to pursue? Because being a doctor, being an engineer, being a lawyer is really not the answer. And always, some folks take it the wrong way, where they feel like, if I become a doctor, I'm going to be rich. I manage thousands of doctors on a daily basis, and I can tell you they're not rich, with respect to Dr. Zay. They're not rich. They put in so many hours, and for the pay that they're getting, it's really not enough. So I would say expand your horizons as well. So thank you. Ms. Isra, do you think social or economic status or the name of a university matters for someone to grow in their professional career? Is it really school or experience? Because, and the reason I'm asking this is because I have recently started to hear a lot of this, misuse of, a lot of the parents were influencing their children. You have to go to Vanderbilt University. If you don't go to Vanderbilt University, then no other university. You have to go to David Lipscomb or this other university. You cannot go to Tennessee State University because, it's a certain population that goes there and it's not successful. So can you elaborate a little bit on that, please?
So of course, it's always it's hard to pick which college, university, or community college to go to at first. But again, it all goes back to your goals and your dreams and what you want to accomplish. So we said depending on your goals and your dreams and what you want to accomplish in life. So I think definitely wherever you go, what you put in is what you will get out. If you go to Vanderbilt, if you go to TSU, if you go to MTSU, if you go to Nashville State, I don't care where you go, it's what you put in is what you will get out. Okay, so remember that always. And of course, it's nice to go to a fancy school, but the last thing that we want to do is go to a fancy school that we cannot afford and get into a lot of debt to impress people. That's definitely not something that we want to do. And in my experience, you can get a very good education at a state school, and your goal should be to get your undergrad for as little as possible, or for free if you can get scholarships, or if you can get grants. But definitely, it's about what you want to do, it's about your goals, and not what everybody else is doing. So always about you and your goals. Because when you graduate after 4 years, you are the one that's going to carry the debt, okay, of the college.
So that's what I didn't talk about experience, but.
No problem. I can just elaborate a little bit on that. So from my own experience, definitely education is very important, and a degree is important, but I will tell you all of you one thing. Experience is the number one thing. I, even when I hire folks, that's the one thing I look at. Education, honestly, the degree is a lot of times the last thing, but experience is the most important thing. So, while going through education, your degree, try to seek a lot of internship out there. And also, when you're done with education, don't expect to get a job right out of that. Go spend time, do a lot of internship. That's how you'll attract a lot of employers. Welcome, Mayor. Sorry, kind of had my panelists all nervous as you walk. She froze. It's okay, talk. we're very pleased to have you. Ms. Krishna, can you tell me what is meant by mental health or someone that is actually diagnosed or has a mental illness? Because this is the one thing that a lot of people get these two phrases incorrectly. So can you just elaborate a little bit the difference between the two, please?
So mental health and mental illness, they're different. Mental health is like physical health. It's on a spectrum. Everyone
has some level of mental health. Mental illness, on the other hand, is diagnosable. There's a severity, there's a frequency, and there's a duration to it. It's an illness that comes from an augmentation or a reduction of regular function so much that it impacts your daily functioning. For example, anxiety. We all get anxious at certain times. I am super anxious right now. I was extremely anxious before we started this, and I think everyone in here knows that because I told everyone that I'm anxious. But a person suffering from an anxiety disorder becomes so anxious that he or she can't go about his or her regular day activities. That's when we diagnose a person with like generalized anxiety disorder or social anxiety. Mental health includes our emotional, our psychological, and social well-being. It affects how we think, how we feel, and how we act. It also helps determine how we handle stress, how we relate to others, and make choices. Mental health is important at every stage of life, from childhood, adolescence, through adulthood. Over the course of your life, if you experience mental health problems, your thinking, your mood, and your behavior can be affected. Many factors contribute to mental health problems, including biological factors such as your genes or your brain chemistry, life experiences such as trauma or abuse, family history of mental health problems. Everyone has mental health, but not everyone experiences mental illness.
Okay, thank you so much. I apologize for running a little bit out of time. So I'm going to open up the Q&A session for the audience. Please feel free to ask any questions, and we will pass around the mic, not the number.
I have a question to Dr. Esra, because she said a very important line, which is knowing your values when you go to school. Would you please let us know what kind of values, where do they get it from, who's responsible to teach them the values?
A very hard question, but I'll try my best to answer. So just speaking from experience, for 4 years I was part of my cohort in NTSU, and I was dealing with the oddball. I was the only one that's different. That was different. I was the one with hijab. I was the only one that was an immigrant. But I always stuck to my beliefs, like, and they told me that they really appreciated that about me. So values such as, just for example, and time to pray. Whenever it was a time for me to pray, I went and I spoke to my advisor that, you know, at this time I will go and pray. And I was making sure to make time for that. So, and just among many others. And I think, of course, values. You learn values from your family, from the community. So it's, when they say it takes a village to teach a child, really that is true. So all of us have to do our job and our share to really uplift our youth, to encourage them, to support them, to provide activities and avenues for them where they can come and learn. And so that's, of course, it comes from school, from home, the environment. But I just learned that you gain the respect of people by upholding these values, and having these values help you make choices in life. Any questions? Any other questions? I think we have a very shy audience.
Hey everyone, thank you again for hosting this. This is actually really beneficial in my defense. So, because I'm not ever active in the Kurdish community, just because, and this leads to my question, comparison. I don't like to be compared to like everyone else, or like, and that also I feel like that holds you to be your own person. And just to hear like, hey, your options are to be doctor, engineer, or whatnot, you know. So as for everyone else, like, do you, or Frisha, I don't know if you get any cases, but do you feel like that's a big burden upon the youth, as for seeing your parents compare you to every other child or person out there?
Oh my gosh, you're like speaking to me right now. Because yes, absolutely. My brother is in medical school. My cousin's just completed PA school. I have other relatives that are nurses. My sister's a nurse in nursing school. I have cousins that are in nursing school say yes all the time. Like, we're always getting compared, and it's such a burden on us, and it stresses us so much. And I don't think that our parents understand this, and we do it to ourselves as well. We compare ourselves to one another, and it increases our anxiety, it increases our stress, and oftentimes it does lead to depression. And so yes, to answer your question, yes, it is a huge burden, and I don't think you realize that we do it to our youth, and we do it to ourselves as well.
I can add a
point. Did that answer your question?
Thank you.
And I can add a point to that too.
From experience, since I was a child, I actually get good grades really in school, and it was going to be a medical doctor. So in high school, that was in my mind that I would be a medical doctor. But then I went to college, I really decided that was not the thing for me. And then I wasted a year and a half of my college trying computer science. I was trying to stick to the sciences. I tried, computer science, computer information systems. And until somebody from the outside came to me, okay, what do you like to do? I told them, I like working with children, and I like the psychology and all those things too. And they asked me, why don't you go to education? But then it took such a long time for that to be accepted. And then I remember when I went back home for the first time, so they asked me, what's your profession and whatnot, and told them education, like Ma'alima, and they looked at me with such a disappointing, like, wow, Ma'alima? I was like, yes, in my So really, as a community, we need to get out of, we need to zoom out, and we need to not do that. We need to encourage all the careers are valuable, because this, because if you don't know what these words say, it will hurt our youth a lot.
So.
What are you talking about? Manastai and Kurdistan are very respected. They're the most bravest.
Okay, so my question is for Binyat. Since you've been here about a year, maybe 2 years, what do you think of the Nashville Kurdish population and kind of what we have to offer coming from the outside?
One of the reasons why we came here to Nashville was because of the Kurdish community here. And going abroad and being part of a different community in a different country, of course you go there to explore and to be adventurous, to explore more and become part of a different society, but there's also huge importance of sticking to your values and remembering who you are. And I think it was because seeing the Kurdish culture and the Kurdish part of us as a great asset, and we wanted to add more to the community and become part of this Kurdish community here. And I think so far this year it's been great. We have met many people, Kurdish people, and here, and they've been very generous. And of course, they've really shown the true hospitality of the Kurdish people here.
So I have one question for Mr. Binyas, and we are here today with a lot of focus on education, mental health. But the one question I want to ask you in terms of handling refugees and settlement and having come into a new life, I want to ask you one specific question from your particular question, and this has nothing to do with our views on the travel ban or pro or against, but just as an immigrant, in your experience, coming with your family to the United States, regardless, it could happen any other problem that came out along in your way to prevent you from having a smooth transition. So my specific question for you is, what do you think our Kurdish community in Nashville could have done better to make the handling of this obstacle in your family's way better? And what can we do moving forward to help prevent such things from happening, because that eventually can affect education and mental health and other aspects?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it is really important for us, for the Kurdish community here, to be more educated about this kind of issues, because this is not a criticism by any means, but things like social justice and the refugee resettlement issue and immigration, they fall into the social justice category. And so far, coming here, having this obstacle in front of us, and coming to the in here, we didn't really feel the as much support as there could have been. For example, I think there could be a more things like the Kurdish professionals that are doing right now. This is really great to bring the community together, for us to be more in harmony and in more connection with each other. And of course, I think there was a lot of many great people who came and helped us and supported us. And I think more importantly, we need to have a more vocal voice in terms of how much, because last year we had people, Kurdish, like in the Kurdish community, being deported and being targeted by ICE to be sent back. And that's, and I think there could have been a more strong response from us, the Kurdish community, because we do belong here and this is our community, and we have such a big presence here in Nashville and Middle Tennessee that we can really make changes and in Tennessee and in Nashville. And it's important to realize our importance here and to realize our voice and to speak out against this kind of injustices.
Hello everyone, salam. I'm Chen, I'm from China, and I have a question for you guys. What is the separate of Islam for you? And how does your religion affect your thinking, your feeling, and your behavior? Thank you.
I'd like to answer it from a mental standpoint. Religion is very important to me, and I try to follow my religion as much as I possibly can, though there's so much more that I can do. But religion is also important to mental health. So a stigma that we do have is just pray about it, or make dua and you'll get better if you're depressed. Though praying does not help in severe cases such as major depressive disorder, because there's a chemical imbalance. Being mindful in your prayer does help oftentimes. So there was actually a study completed that showed individuals who were mindful in their prayer versus individuals who were not mindful in their prayer. Those that were mindful, and Dr. Zain, you can correct me if I'm wrong in this, but those that were mindful showed very little activity in the front of their brain, and they had a lot of activity in the back of their brain. So those that were not mindful had a lot of activity in the front of their brain. And then having all of this blood flow and all of this activity in the front of their brain, it showed that levels of anxiety increased, levels of stress increased. They were not mindful in their prayer. But those that were mindful and there was not all of this activity in the front of their brain, they were more, these levels of stress and anxiety were not there. What actually was there was a lot of activity in the back of the brain, where the gratification and the reward system comes from. So those that were mindful found that their prayer, it helped to decrease their anxiety, it helped to decrease depression. So though praying is not always the answer to everything, and it can't cure you of schizophrenia, and it cannot cure you of a major depressive disorder, it does help as far as self-care.
So for me, my faith is part of who I am. So it's about being a whole person. So wherever I go, my faith is part of me, okay? So with a lot of our youth, it's a big struggle when you go to school and having that double personality. So at home, you are a certain way, you act a certain way, you behave a certain way with your parents when they're around, but when you go to school, you become a total different person. Okay, for some of the girls, it involves, dressing differently, and this really negatively impacts you as a person, as a human being. So for me, my faith is part of who I am. I'm a whole person. If I'm with my parents, if I'm with my friends, or if I'm at school, it's the same person. If I'm online, it's me. So being your whole self, always be who you are. So it's very important for me. It's part of my identity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I just want to say that I think I am a secular Muslim, and I think I believe in the idea that government and religion are different things. But when I came to the United States, I sort of rediscovered my spirituality and my sense of self, and it's a part of my identity, and it's a way to kind of remember who I am and build upon that, and build up, because for 18, 20 years, that's been something that affected me, who I am and my personality. And even though I am I don't think that religion should play a big role in society as a whole. I think it's important for us to view religion as a way to figure out who we are and to, especially in the somewhere who we are not from, in the United States, in the West. It is a way that we can still preserve our values and protect our values and figure out where we stand in the situation.